Hello and welcome to ILTV's Israel Daily. I'm Aaron Porras, and coming up in today's newscast, two terror attacks hit Israel on Sunday as citizens are still reeling from the tragedy at Mount Meron over the weekend. Meanwhile, as memorials for Mount Meron end, investigations begin. And finally, Prime Minister Netanyahu's mandate to form a coalition ending tonight. Stay tuned for the details. Three 19-year-old yeshiva students in Israel were injured and two of them in serious condition following a drive-by shooting attack near the Tapuach Junction in Judea and Samaria Sunday evening. The deadly and unprovoked terror attack targeting civilians waiting at a bus stop, and the suspects afterward escaping the scene despite IDF troops nearby returning fire. Soldiers also reinforced the area with combat troops, set up roadblocks, and have launched a manhunt for the perpetrators, though the suspects still have yet to be found. Defense Minister Benny Gantz saying that the IDF and security forces will not rest until they get their hands on the terrorists responsible. As for the victims, medics on scene say two victims, Yehuda Guetta from Jerusalem and Benaya Peretz from Beit She'an, were in critical condition, bobbing in and out of consciousness while receiving treatment en route to the hospital. The third victim, Amichai Hala from Tzfat, meantime, thankfully, only sustaining light injuries. Meanwhile, this whole shooting taking place just hours after an earlier attempted terror attack at the Gush Etzion Junction south of Bethlehem. A Palestinian woman armed with a knife attempting to stab soldiers before they fired back, neutralizing her. No other injuries have been reported. Now, Sunday's Palestinian terror attacks coming as Israelis are still mourning the 45 victims killed over Lag BaOmer holiday weekend at Mount Meron.
A national day of mourning coming to a close Sunday night, called for by Israeli leaders out of respect for the 45 victims killed in a crowd crush incident on Friday in the early morning hours. And while most of the over 150 wounded in the Mount Meron disaster have been discharged, several are still hospitalized with more severe conditions. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu among their many visitors.
טיפול הנפלא שהם מקבלים על ידי הצוות הרפואי, כפי שהתרשמתי גם מפעולת החילוץ שללא ספק הציל החיים, כולל של חלק מהאנשים שנמצאים כאן. אנחנו מתפללים לשלומם. אחד ההורים אמר לי את המשפט שמסכם את הכל. הוא אמר, פה מגלים שעם ישראל יש לו לב אחד. וליבנו עם הפצועים וכולנו מייחלים להם וגם מתפללים להחלמתם המלאה.
As for those who perished, all 45 have now been identified, and the list, including many parents, 10 foreign nationals, and at least 10 children under 18, some as young as 9 and some sets of brothers, leaving waves of heartbreak worldwide.
It's probably one of the biggest tragedies that has happened in the last many, many years. It's shook up everybody, and I think it's making the people feel that we're not looking at which group you're from or who you are. Everybody's heart is going out today to those people that were lost, and it's an unfortunate situation.
Meanwhile, as officials, victims, and witnesses begin pointing fingers, probes into the deadly Mount Meron tragedy are already beginning. State authorities asking the public for calm and for cooperation with the investigations.
זה נס שאף אחד לא נפל לי על הראש. זוועה. אי אפשר לתאר את זה ואי אפשר להסביר את זה. זה לא יוצא לך מהראש.
Harrowing images from the tragedy at Mount Meron, leaving many around the country angry and looking for answers. And attention primarily directed now towards the government, or the painfully apparent lack thereof. As protesters spell shame with candles outside Public Security Minister Amir Ohana's home in Tel Aviv, and call for immediate investigations and action.
We're basically here to say that we cannot go on living normally without looking at people are losing their lives and losing families and losing loved ones without doing anything. This government is a mistake. This government is a criminal mistake, and it needs to go. And that's why we're here.
Well, while government heads may not resign over this anytime soon, with respect to the probes, so far, the Justice Ministry's Police Internal Investigations Department, as well as the Israel Police, have already launched independent probes.
ברצוני להודיע היום כי יש בכוונתי לפתוח בביקורת מיוחדת אשר תתחקר את הנסיבות שהובילו לאסון זה.
Engelman going on to explain that his investigations will be free from political influence and will focus on three main issues. First, the conduct and actions of political decision makers, police, and rescue workers. Second, the oversight and management of the holy site, including to what extent authorities followed up on earlier reported warnings. And third, how to best manage future events at the shrine. Meanwhile, standing just shy of taking full responsibility, Ohana and other security and police officials agreeing to cooperate fully with all investigations, saying everything is being done so that such a disaster does not happen again in Israel. Likewise, a group of former Israeli police commissioners and former police major generals sending a letter to Prime Minister Netanyahu, Justice Minister Benny Gantz, Attorney General Avichai Mandelblit, and other top-ranking officials. And the letter calling for a full-fledged state commission of inquiry into the Mount Meron disaster be formed. Supporters of forming a committee, including Gantz, arguing that only a state commission will be able to manage all aspects of an investigation into such a disaster. Still, Israelis are mostly disillusioned by such talk, with even many state officials saying it's a miracle the Meron crush didn't happen sooner, and that it only happened in one location at the site. In fact, the grave site on Mount Meron has long been known to be unsafe, and especially when bogged by tens of thousands of revelers. For one, on Lag BaOmer in 1911, another 11 people were killed and 40 were wounded when a balcony railing collapsed behind the weight. For decades, people were surprised when an incident didn't happen. And the deadly, slippery, poorly routed exit ramp where dozens were killed on Friday was built without a permit or oversight just a couple of years ago, following a fire that broke out. And finally, multiple official government reports and committee inquiries in 2008, 2011, 2017, 2018, and even 2021 raised concerns for safety due to decades of neglect and mismanagement.
Joining me now to discuss the investigations into the disaster at Mount Meron, former Knesset member, former commander of the Yamam Counterterrorism Unit, and former commander of the Police Central District overseeing Tel Aviv Jaffa, retired Major General David Tzul. Thank you so much for being with us now. This tragedy at initial glances seemed like a terrible accident, but now an investigation is launched and gross negligence as well as lack of oversight are the words being most thrown around. What are the probes looking for?
Okay. Because it's a very multi-layer event, which is not a regular event like we know, you know, like concert or football games, large sport events. As we know, so there is one manager, a producer, or a entity like can be municipality or other organization that the police is the regulator, which is coming with the requirements, and they have to stick to the requirements. And once they do that, the police will sign and will execute the responsibility of each one of the different organization. In this case, it's a religious ceremony. You saw this year, even it's less than the years before, which I was personally on the mountain for my duties. Wow. You can count more than 300, 400,000 people. Unfortunately, it's a very small place for this kind of event. Also, unfortunately, every 13 years, it's coming to Thursday, which is before the Shabbat is entering. So there's a pressure to push all the ceremonies on different sections of the religious. So everything is being pushed in a way that created this kind of a disaster. So now the investigation will have to go and dig into details for each one of the responsibilities of each one of the organization, which the police, of course, is the one of the main cases to because they are responsible for the security, safety, and regulator.
And so I know that in fact that's one of the things that the probes are investigating, the actions and the behaviors of the police and rescue workers and other authorities. So knowing what you know, having even been there in prior years, do you believe that authorities on the ground acted to the best of their abilities?
Well, I know personally the General of the North, Major General Lavi, and I know some of the other, the headquarters, of course, the commissioner. Definitely I can say that the planning and all the other things which should be done before definitely were done. The question is the execution. And the gap between that to that incident, which definitely shouldn't happen, this is something to be checked. And why we're insisting on a committee which is not investigation, which only against the police, like now they put the Mahash, which is the Interior Investigation Unit against the police, which is very aiming only the police responsibility. This is something which definitely I think it's wrong, and it won't bring the truth. And also the most important thing, we won't have a real picture to get the conclusions for the future. So I can tell you, in my background also, I was a Knesset member, and I was in charge of the Knesset also for reviewing the government activities on the mountain, on Meron. And it's like going back, and all the comments were there. The infrastructure, lack of infrastructure, which the prime minister, from the prime minister to the ministers and going down, this is something which should have been done. And unfortunately, not a lot have been done. I can say that on the traffic issues, a lot of investment were done. Some of the tunnels which were built in order to make different ways for cars and buses to pedestrians, that was done. But unfortunately, the main infrastructure for security and safety on the mountain, nothing was done.
All right, Major General David Sewell, thank you again so much for your insights.
Thank you, Aaron.
In other news, today marks Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's final chance to build a coalition. His mandate, handed down by President Reuven Rivlin, expiring at midnight. And still, it seems that neither left nor right-leaning parties have a shot at creating a government. Joining me with more, Israeli journalist and attorney Ben Dolwi Amini. Ben Dolwi, it's a pleasure to have you back. Thank you so much. Now, has anything new happened that might give us hope for a government under Netanyahu or otherwise? Is Netanyahu's chance, at least this time, over?
Okay, the main thing that should happen now is that Yair Lapid and others from his bloc should send flowers to Benjamin Netanyahu. And you might ask me, why should they send flowers? I'll tell you why, because in the first stage, what it is to enable any kind of partnership, coalition with the Arab parties. Today, just not long time ago, he enabled them actually to let Naftali Bennett to be the first prime minister. Only 2 weeks ago, he declared a head of a party with seven seats in the Knesset cannot be the prime minister. And right now he's saying he can be the prime minister. So if he can be the prime minister with the Likud, he can be the prime minister also with the change block of Yair Lapid and others.
Well, so where do we go from here? Will the change block manage to pull something together, either under Lapid or Bennett, as you said, or are we heading to fifth elections?
Yeah, well, according to what happened today with the declaration, with this kind of proposal of Benjamin Netanyahu to Naftali Bennett, come and be the first prime minister, actually he pushed Naftali Bennett to the change block, to Yair Lapid's block. Right now, I mean, if yesterday evening it looked like that maybe Netanyahu is going to form a government because a new kind of ruling by some rabbis, right now it looks like that it's changing again, and right now the probability of Netanyahu to form a government is becoming lower and lower, and it looks like if Lapid, Bennett, and Saar are on their way to form a government. Is it going to happen? Everything can happen in the Israeli politics, but right now that's the new direction.
Is there any chance of some form of government appearing that will be stable, in your opinion?
I think that Naftali Bennett is completely right when he's saying that if he will be the prime minister, it will be a unity government, because it's the only government that will combine, in a way, right-wing parties and center and left-wing parties. So he is completely right. Now, is it going to be stable? That's something that we do not know. But according to what we know about the personality, because we are speaking now about personality, it's not the policy of Netanyahu that disabled actually forming a new government. It's his personality. So right now, it looks like if Naftali Bennett has the right personality in order to unite the parties from the right and parties from the left, and maybe it will happen. It will happen. And anyway, this kind of government can be much more stable comparing to other options that we have. Yes, it's going to be, if it will be, a unity government.
All right, Bendel Yamini, thank you again so much.
Thank you for having me.
Moving on, Israel's parliamentary elections may still continue repeating, but the Palestinian legislative vote has been postponed indefinitely again, and all allegedly because of Israel. Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas blaming his decision on Israel's refusal to allow the vote to include parts of Jerusalem.
أمام هذا الوضع الصعب قررنا تأجيل موعد إجراء الانتخابات التشريعية لحين ضمان مشاركة القدس وأهلها في هذه الانتخابات. فلا تنازل عن القدس ولا تنازل عن حق شعبنا في القدس في ممارسة حقه الديمقراطي.
That said, while some support Abbas's decision, most are accusing him of unjustly stripping them of their rights and an interest of maintaining his own position of power.
اليوم لنعلن موقف واضح وصريح يقول لا للتأجيل. نعم لإجراء الانتخابات كاستحقاق وطني ديمقراطي إنقاذي للساحة الفلسطينية ولا نجد أي مبرر أو ذريعة تدفع أصحاب القرار ومن يهيمنون على القرار أن يلجأوا لتأجيل هذه الانتخابات تحت أي حجة كانت.
أنا كمواطن كشاب فلسطيني أطالب بإجراء الانتخابات، أطالب بحق الانتخابي من أجل رؤية وجوه جديدة، من أجل شباب، من أجل وضع سياسي جديد. إن شاء الله إنه يكون في انتخابات، وإن شاء الله إنه إحنا كلياتنا ننتخب حتى في القدس، حتى في السفارات، حتى في كل فلسطين وليست القدس أيضا، في كل فلسطين.
Now, a movement driven by a 4,000-year-old dream to come home to a land of hope and promise, a place where the Jewish people could be free, Zionism supports the Jewish people's right to self-determination. Yet ever since the United Nations wrongly attacked Zionism as racism in an infamous 1975 resolution, which the UN itself later revoked, supporters of Israel have had to continue their campaigns against misinformation spread by Israel's detractors. And here to tell us all about one such campaign by JNF USA, JNF USA spokesperson Yael Levantine. Thank you so much for being with us, Yael.
Hi, Aaron. Thank you for having us.
All right, so I have to ask, you know, the first question I have is for you. Like, the campaign is titled, This is What Zionism Looks Like, Join the Conversation.
Yes.
What can you tell us about it?
So Jewish National Fund USA recently launched a This Is What Zionism Looks Like campaign. And the whole aim of this campaign is to reclaim the beauty, the diversity, the inclusiveness of Zionism. We want to have a real conversation about what Zionism is. Is Zionism one shade of color or one people or one thought process? No, Zionism for you can mean one something, and Zionism for me can be something totally different. But it is inclusive, and it's beautiful, and it's respectful. And that's what Zionism is. So we are aiming to open a conversation about New Age Zionism.
Yeah, that leads me really to my next question. What inspired this campaign from JNF USA, and what is its primary goals, I should say?
I think the aim is to open up a conversation, to have everybody come in and talk and to claim what Zionism means to them. There's a movement going on all across the world. So why not start this conversation right now? Why wait for later on to have these conversations?
So how does JNF USA plan to do this?
Well, there's a couple stages for this campaign. So the first stage would be claim your frame on Facebook. You would go to share.jnf.org, and what you would do is just post your picture. I mean, Zionism for you could be art, it could be food, it could be your family, it could be a selfie, it could be really anything that speaks to you of what Zionism means to you. And then the second stage would be sharing your story of Zionism. And again, that could just be a sentence, it could be a paragraph, it could be an entire blog or a video or TikTok, dance music, it could be anything that you feel incorporates what you feel is Zionism. And then the third stage is going to be monthly conversations with the CEO of Jewish National Fund, Mr. Russell Robinson. And he's going to be speaking with change makers from across the world, discussing what is Zionism, and really touching on even the more sticky issues and bigger questions that might come up.
So more in that, why now? Because we know that this is a long-going battle.
This is a long-term, right.
So what is there anything particular that happened recently that sort of led to this project being started?
So I really like that question, Aaron. You asked me why now, and I'm going to ask you why not now? Why wait to tomorrow? Why wait for our kids or our grandchildren to pick it up and say, okay, now we'll start dealing with Zionism? As we have lost too many generations to the hijacking of the meaning of the word Zionism. You should be proud to be a Zionist. Kids on campus in the States should be proud to be a Zionist. People living in LA or in New York or in Israel or in Tel Aviv should be proud to be Zionists. We have people in the UAE that are saying, hey, we're proud Zionists as well. This is the time to do it.
All right, so the heart of this Where's the upcoming live visible on Tuesday night?
Oh, I'm so excited about this. Yeah, so our CEO of Jewish National Fund USA, Russell Robinson, is going to be here in Israel, his first trip back to Israel after COVID. We haven't seen him, I think, since last March. And he could go anywhere in the world, but he's like, no, I'm coming home. So he got on the first plane that he could, and he came here, and he's going to be on live with ILTV with the beautiful Emmanuel Kadosh. And they are going to be discussing what is Zionism, what it means to him. So since it's a Facebook Live event, people should come on and engage and ask questions and be part of that conversation.
Well, I'm happy that that conversation is open to the public, especially not just live for the public for viewing. Yael Levontine from JNF USA, thank you so much again.
Thank you, Aaron.
All right, so once again, if you are interested in seeing the Facebook Live interview with ILTV's Emmanuel Kadosh and JNF USA, you can join us at ILTV's Facebook page tomorrow, Tuesday at 5 p.m. Israel time. You can log in live and ask your own questions as well. Again, that is Tuesday at 5 p.m. Israel time on ILTV's Facebook page. Join us live. And now let's take a look at the weather forecast with Chana Rifkin.
Thanks, Aaron. Now, lows this evening between 16 to 18 degrees Celsius, and highs tomorrow will once again be in the 30s in the majority of the country and the upper 20s in the Haifa and Tel Aviv areas. Skies will be a bit cloudy today and tomorrow. Back to the studio now.
Thank you, Chana. Now, before we go, let's take a look at what's going viral in Israel.
מי אמר שרק בטסלה יש נהג אוטומטי ומי אמר שרק בטסלה אפשר לנהוג לישון תוך כדי נהיגה הנה הבן אדם שהמציא את טסלה נמצא פה לידינו והנה הוא יושן וזה נקרא נהג אוטומטי וזה הנהג אז טסלה יש לכם הרבה מה ללמוד
Come on, Elon. Elon Musk, get on that. All right, that's it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.28 shekels to the American dollar and 2.64 shekels to the Canadian dollar. Finally, for the latest updates and news from ILTV, please like ILTV on Facebook, Follow us on Instagram and subscribe to our YouTube channel as well as to our newsletter at iltv.tv. I'm Aaron Porras. Be well. Thank you so much for watching.